Thank you. It's great to be here, and I want to thank and congratulate Peg and Why There Are Words series. I read here about maybe about 5 years ago, and it was like tonight, packed, a warm audience. It's lovely that it's going. I know how hard it is. I co-direct a reading series at Chico State. It's a lot of work, so I'm deeply appreciative. It's great to be here. I'm going to read a few flash fictions from my book, Spectators. It's my third book. My first two books were are sort of character-driven literary realism, which I deeply love, but wanted to do something really different with this book. So I made a few kind of arbitrary rules for myself, some of them like nothing over a page, get away from plot and conflict, try it, and try to be more lyric and just play around with the language a bit more. So this piece that I'm going to read is called Skyglider. Oh, the other thing you might want to know. Every piece in this book was inspired by another work of art, mostly visual art, photography, and some literature. So this is a photograph by a photographer named Tom Patton. If you've been to Santa Cruz, you know the sky glider. It's the sort of chairlift thing that goes around in an oval. He took this wonderful picture of a person just completely disinterested, right? And of course, the Santa Cruz boardwalk is, it is what it is, but it's a beautiful area. How could you be disinterested? Anyway, Skyglider above the Santa Cruz boardwalk. Skyglider floats above the crowd, hovers over and above the crowd, a spectacle to behold. Behold a dream of elevation. Behold a dream of escape. Escape all attention. Dispense no favors. Judge none other than oneself. Self-interested and sublime, Skyglider is a perfect fiction, a willing, milling, million people's dream. Dream of purpose, dream of goals, dream a reason to be. Be in this world, having created it. It appears there's nothing to do but ride around this world in circles, ignoring countless pleas for intervention. He's indifferent. For a miracle, he's powerless. For hope, he is hopeless. Helpless is Skyglider, hovering over and above this world of goals and outcomes, predictions and rewards. Reword the litany of the log flume. Chant down the ceremony of the tilt-a-whirl. Upend the blessing of the bumper cars. Cars he rides in endless circles, first this way, then that. That he hovers above the milling millions he created means nothing. Nothing, but why? Why, asks he who hates the world he created, because he is not, can never be part of it. It pains him to wonder who made him, why they took the trouble to make Skyglider. The next piece I'll read is was inspired by a photograph by a photographer named Stephanie Schaefer. She takes wonderful photos. I live in Chico, so the North Valley, and she takes wonderful landscape photography of the North Valley. And she took a shot of a very small town called Los Molinos in between Chico and Redding. And she took a wonderful shot of somebody standing in the street in the tule fog in the dawn. Oh, that's not the piece I'm going to read. I'm sorry. It's a really good photo, though. No, I want to read one called Roadside Marker. You've all seen these on the side of the road, right, when there's a car crash, a fatality, that people put up a little altar. So this one's called Roadside Marker. A roadside marker, thinks Walter, is an exercise in revisionist history, an écriture of the heart. It's an attempt to say something to others that no doubt was misunderstood or unheard while the deceased was alive. Words, gestures, gifts left not for the dead, but for the living, to reassure them that they did what they were supposed to have done, that they loved as much as they could, that they cherished and valued and complimented the beloved when, and Walter knows this, the guy who drove his Ford into that tree last March It is a real son of a bitch. Walter's monument, should he actually build one, would not look backward. There stands a litany of failure and despair, lost opportunities and half-realized goals. Walter's monument would be to the future, to the lives and possibilities still unborn and becoming, to the potential surrounding us, to the alternatives we can't yet embrace, the decisions we don't have the courage to make, the adventures we dream of and promise that we'll attend to tomorrow. The idealized future is every ounce the lie that is the idealized past, but with one difference. There is that tender slice of possibility, the promise of what if, the knowledge that with the next turn, the next blank page, the next girl you meet, your life might change. Walter waits for something to happen, for when that something happens, the past will be rewritten to anticipate what it couldn't have foretold, which is chance, really, sanctifying the present by making it inevitable. I'll read one more piece. This piece was inspired not by a visual image, but by a piece of literature. Probably a lot of you know this piece, Borges and I, by Jorge Luis Borges. Wonderful little one-page thing, you know, that ends with famously with, I don't know which one of us is writing this page. So there used to be a literary journal called Enteas, and they published a special issue a few years ago where they invited a series of writers to do their own take on that, Borges and I. And I remember when I was a grad student, back in the days when you had to actually go to the physical library to get, and I found that issue and I just sat there and read it, you know, it was just so mind-blowing. And so eventually I thought, well, I'll write one of my own. This is called Author's Note. My name is Rob. I work for Davidson. It is I, Rob, who has a wife and two children. I mow my lawn, vote my conscience, didn't do much good, wave to the neighbors. If there are a few hard-earned dollars in my bank account, it's because I work. I spend roughly 400 hours each year in a classroom or a lecture hall, standing before students and colleagues, talking about what he, Davidson, does. I speak his language, one of drafting and revision, artifice and craft, form and content. I do this willingly, without an ounce of resentment, all for Davidson. He couldn't live for 5 minutes without me, his Rob. Davidson lives just 2 hours a day, longer in summer or during winter breaks. He might resurrect himself for 4 or 5 hours a day then. But during the school year, when I have my son's soiled diaper in one hand and a student essay in the other, and the phone is ringing, he's damn lucky to get his 2 hours, believe me. He's greedy, you see. If you overlook him, ignore him, try to forget about him, he'll be right there at my throat, scratching and pleading and making his incessant and ultimately unstoppable demands. So I rearrange my life to accommodate him. I make and cancel plans. I schedule my trips to the grocery, the playground, the post office around his 2 hours. I teach my classes and earn my paycheck so that he, Davidson, may live. Occasionally, I'm invited to read his work before some group or other. A few people might want to line up afterwards to buy a book and ask questions. They want, of course, to speak with him. I cannot muster the courage to tell them he didn't come. He is never, ever available for this kind of public appearance. No one can ever see him, visit, or ask him a question. He shall never respond. He lives, you see, a strange kind of existence hidden away in that room of his, tapping away on his keyboard, constructing his city of language. No, not city. Sorry, Davidson, you haven't yet written your city, not even a town, a village perhaps, a hamlet. It is there he lives, issuing all too infrequently his latest missive, a small bundle of white paper with neat black ink printing words. He's most proud of that, only that, I suppose, for that's all he really is, a wordsmith, kind of artisan or craftsman. That's the one thing, really the only thing that he does. Me? I'm not exactly proud of him. Grateful in a way. Oddly enough, it's what he does that allows me to do what I do. Teaching allows me to pay the mortgage on my house, buy my kids a new shirt or a book, take the wife out for dinner and a movie now and again. Teaching allows me to live my ordinary, quiet life in my ordinary, quiet cul-de-sac in this ordinary, quiet town. It's only when someone has taken the time and the trouble to read his books and then makes the connection between him and me, Davidson and his rod, that the trouble begins. It is there, you see, on the page, that the mistake occurs. We are constantly mistaken for one another. His readers, you happy few, especially those who know me, Rob, sometimes mistakenly think that they see me on the page in some incident or action, some image or quip of dialogue. But they are never correct. Davidson has fooled them because he's a thief. He steals unmercifully, without conscience or compunction, from those closest to him and from the world at large. Mostly he steals from me, from my memory. You would think that I would resent that. I probably should. For when he steals a memory, he doesn't simply take it verbatim. Invariably he changes it, paints the red barn blue, makes me taller, smarter, quicker than I am, or dumber, uglier, Republican. Or he puts me in Phoenix when I was really in Houston. He makes me older or younger, changes my name, my sex, my occupation. As I say, I should probably resent that, but I do not. Far from it. For it is precisely then, when he's changed me so much that I cannot recognize myself, that I see myself most clearly. And I love him for that. That is why I work unstintingly for him, making sure that his 2 hours are given freely and are taken without interruption or distraction. It is not that Davidson cannot exist without his Rob, but there is no Rob without his Davidson. There is no reality that is not finally mediated by an elaborate fantasy.